Welcome back again. So yesterday we have this particular topic we were discussing about the Moore's law of integration. So as I told you about the Moore's law of integration, it was the Jordan Moore, who was the co-founder of the Intel technology. He actually predicted one of the basic concept, how our transistor is, the size of the transistor is getting reduced. And then he predicted that in every 18 months or around 24 months, the number of transistors which can be integrated or embedded into a particular chip is getting doubled. So that was the Moore's law of integration. So this is the topic that we were discussing yesterday. So it was actually Jordan Moore stated this particular thing in the year of 1965. So it is already the beginning of this IC industries, right? So 1960 we had the MOSFET, and then in 1958 or 1959 we had a particular first IC that we have fabricated. And in 1965 this was the prediction done by the Jordan Moore that the number of transistors that can be integrated onto a particular IC or particular silicon chip, it can be doubled in every 18 months, or somewhere you will find it is in every 24 months. So either it is 2 years or 1.5 years, no matters. So within this 2 years, the number of transistors are getting doubled. And why it happens? Because there is a reduction in the size of the transistor. And I told you that the reduction of the size of the transistor is given a particular name, which is called as the miniaturization of transistor. Okay. So this terminology you will find everywhere, that the miniaturization of the transistor is taking place. And why it is happening? Because of the improvement in the manufacturing processes, the processes that we are following. Okay. So this was the predicted line, and there were a little bit deviation from this predicted line that you can see here, a little deviation you can find. But still, it has been found that even in year of 2020, the people are trying to follow this law. Okay, there are lots of competition. There are lots of competitors. They're trying to follow this particular law. Okay, they're trying to embed more and more number of transistors into a silicon chip so that it can perform the means it can improve the performance of your particular chip or particular devices, whatever they want to make. So this was the Moore's law of integration. You can see this particular figure I have taken from the book, okay, Westey's book. Okay, so you can see number of transistors, okay, that were embedded into a different microprocessors that was produced by your Intel's. Okay. So the Intel's first microprocessor was 4004, okay, and it was introduced in year 1971. And as you know that this were containing the number of transistors were 2300 MOSFETs were there. Okay. So this is our first microprocessor 4004, then 8008, then 8080, then 8086, and so on. Okay. So we can see that up to 2005 or 2006, 2007 or 8, we have go to quad, okay, go to duo microprocessor and go to quad microprocessor we have. And you can see we are having a very large number of transistors in this particular chips. We have a very large number of chips. So why it is possible? Because of the Jordan's Moore's law, okay. This is a Moore's law that is saying that the number of transistors will be getting doubled in every 2 years. And that drastically improvement in the number of transistors you can see from the structure. Okay. So it is very much clear that the number of transistors is increasing very drastically. Fine. So, there are students keep joining, which is making a disturbance. Okay, so now we can move on to the next slide. There is one corollary Okay, one there is one corollary of Moore's law, which is also called as the Dennard's law of scaling. Okay, Dennard's law of scaling or Dennard's scaling law. Okay, so what it says, Dennard's scaling law says, basically when we are decreasing the size of transistor. Okay, so you can read this out. So what it says, it says, when the transistor size shrinks, they become faster and it consume less power and are cheaper to manufacture. This is the law. Okay, this is the Dennard's law of scaling. So what it says, that as the transistor shrink, they become faster, consume less power and are cheaper to manufacture. So obviously, why this transistor becomes very fast when it shrinks? So the reason is, when transistor's size is becoming small, when it shrinks in size, then what happens is, you know that if we reduce the channel length, okay, then this electron need to travel from source to drain, and when this channel length is small, in that time when it is traveling from source to drain, in that time what happens, it will depends on the transit time. Okay, and transit time will depend on the length of the channel. So what we do is, when we are shrinking the size of the transistor, the total distance traveled by the electron from one place to another place, or one terminal to another terminal, that will reduce drastically. Okay, and therefore what happens, because of that, the travel time will reduce and the transistor operation will become faster. Obviously, when it will become small, it will obviously consume less power. And obviously, when it is small in size, the manufacturing process is also becoming cheaper. So this is what your Dennard's law of scaling says. Okay, it is very obvious. When the transistor shrinks, they become faster, they will be consuming less power and are cheaper to manufacture. One more point that we have to understand from this particular comment. Okay, so what is this idea is, so Intel's microprocessor clock frequency have doubled roughly in every 34 months. Okay, so Intel's microprocessor that we are discussing, okay, it was its clock frequency is doubling in every 34 months. You just try to remember, the size of the transistor is reducing in every 24 months or 18 months, and the clock frequency is doubling in every 34 months. Okay, so you might have studied about that the clock frequency of your CPU is 2.5, 2.9 gigahertz or 3 gigahertz, like that. Somewhere you have see that it is 1.6 gigahertz clock frequency. So this frequency scaling heat the power wall around 2004, and clock frequency have leveled off around 3 gigahertz. So what does it mean? Okay, so first of all, what it is saying, that due to the reduction in the size of the transistor, the transistor becomes faster, and when the transistor becomes faster, whatever the microprocessor that we have, its operation can also be become faster, so that we can have a particular clock that will be operated at higher frequencies. And this frequency can be doubled in every 34 months. Okay, so you can see here, we have started with 4004 microprocessor, 4004 microprocessor in 1971. Okay, somewhere in the 1971. So it was having a very less a clock speed that time, less than 1 megahertz. Okay, and then this clock frequency is keep on increasing. Okay, it is keep on increasing, and then you can see it is somewhere around 3 gigahertz. After 3 gigahertz, there is no further increase in the clock frequency is observed. Okay, so that's why what they are saying, that there is a clock frequency which get leveled off around 3 gigahertz. Okay, so after 3 gigahertz, there is no further improvement in the clock frequency. So we cannot improve the performance of the microprocessor in terms of speed after 3 gigahertz. Okay, So that we need to understand how this is taking place, okay, why it is taking place. What is the reason that this particular clock frequency is not going beyond 3 gigahertz? Okay.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Sir, I think some students are waiting outside the meeting. They are disconnected accidentally. Please join them.
Okay. Okay. So now we have to understand why this is leveled off at a particular 3 gigahertz frequency, okay, and why it is difficult to increase the clock frequency further, more than 3 gigahertz. Why it is not possible, why we are not able to increase the clock frequency further. So that we need to understand. So basically what happens is, what we have to understand, basically I told you that whenever we are manufacturing any IC, there must be a certain building blocks, a certain basic element that we have to choose for manufacturing any IC. So for example, if we are making any particular microprocessor, it may be a PMOS technology, it may be NMOS technology, it may be a CMOS technology, or it may be a BiCMOS technology. Okay, so let us say, because I told you that the CMOS is one of the best basic element, because it is having a very small size and it is also consuming very less power. Okay, so that's why many of the manufacturers are following CMOS as the basic, means taking the CMOS as the basic element, and by replicating the CMOS they are manufacturing the ICs or any microprocessors, right? So as you know that this CMOS, okay, CMOS is consuming power only when it is making a transition from one stable state to another stable state. Okay, so when it is making a transition, and we, what we said, even at the stable state it doesn't draw any power. Okay, it will not take any power when it is at their stable state. But what happens is, when we are embedding more and more number of transistors, you can imagine that we are adding 2 billion 3 billion 5 billion transistors, okay, within a very small chip area, very small chip area, we are adding a large number of transistors. Okay, then when this size of the transistor is actually reducing, then what happens is, because of the reduction in the size, okay, there is one problem that actually arises. What is that problem is, we cannot turn off the transistor completely, because its size is so small that it will, even if you trying to turn it off, it will, small current it will means keep consuming. So it is very difficult to turn off this particular transistors completely off. One more thing is that if we are having a billion transistors, like 2 billion, 5 billion, whatever, then if the clock frequency, if we keep on increasing, then every single transistor is making a transition with this speed of 3 gigahertz. Okay, whenever it is required, we'll make a transition. Okay, 3 gigahertz, right? And because there are the billion number of transistors, you can assume that the total power consumed by this particular chip and will be very large. You can imagine that, okay, because we do not have like 100, 200 or 1000 transistors, we are having billions number of transistors. So when billions number of transistors are operating at the same time, and when it is switching at a very high speed, total amount of power consumed will be very large. Okay, and that is actually making a very big thing, okay, that we need to control. Okay, the power consumption is still very high. Okay, so because of that, we could not further increase the clock speed. Okay, either we can go on reduce the size and increase the number of transistors. Okay, so either we can increase the number of transistors, or we can there is a trade off. Okay, there is a trade off between the speed and the power. Okay, so when we want to go on increasing the speed, we cannot increase the number of transistors further. Okay, we cannot increase. We cannot go on increasing the number of transistors, because the power consumed by this particular total number of transistors will be very high. that time will be very difficult to control your chip. Okay, so altogether your chip will be consuming a very high power that time, because we are having a large number of transistors and it is switching at a very high speed. So that's why what they have done is they are increasing the number of transistors, but they are not able to increase the clock frequency further because the power consumption is very high. Okay, so now when somebody is having, or somebody have reached to its maximum clock frequency, okay, so you can see that the microprocessors have already reached to its maximum clock frequency, like 3 gigahertz, then they thought how to further improve the performance, how to speed up the performance. Okay, so because we cannot increase the clock frequency further, agar clock frequency ko agar aap increase kar nahi sakte ho, and if you are not even able to embed more number of transistors, because aisa to hai nahi ki we can go on adding the transistors, okay, because the transistor size cannot be less than atoms. Okay, so we are already working on, like in the yesterday class I told you, we are already working on like 5 nanometer, 10 nanometer technology. It is very small in size, okay, and the performance of the devices are also completely changed, because when we are dealing with the nanometer size, okay, like 22 nanometer, 14 nanometer, then we have to consider the quantum effects. Okay, the quantum effects are completely changing the behavior of the devices, so that also we have to take into account. And the maximum reduction in the size cannot go beyond the atom size, because atom is the smallest entity that we can have. Okay, and even we cannot realize any circuit using the atoms. It is very difficult to manufacture. Okay, so that's why it has already achieved its highest clock frequency, like 3 gigahertz. Now some may ask, like, if it is already achieved its highest clock frequency like 3 gigahertz, then how we can further improve the performance of the microprocessor if it cannot be go beyond 3 gigahertz? Then the answer is, you know that if a certain task is done by a certain person, so let us say that person is very much efficient and he is doing the work with his highest efficiency, like let us say he is putting his 100% effort. So if one person who is very efficient and putting his 100% efficient, and he is doing a particular work, okay, and if he is performing that particular work, he is completing that work in 2 days, right, then if you want to finish off that particular work within the 1 day, then what you will do? The answer is you will add one more person. Okay, you will try to add one more person, because that person is already working with its maximum efficiency. If the efficiency was less than 100%, then what you can do is you will ask him to do the work faster, so that the work which is he is completing in the 2 days, he can complete in the 1 day. Okay, if he was not doing efficiently, but if he is already doing the work with 100% efficiency, then the only way to complete or finish off the work within less time by adding one more person. Okay, if you are adding the same one more person with also having the 100% efficiency, is also giving the same efficiency like the other person, the first person, then obviously this 2 person will be able to finish off the work within the 1 day. Similarly, if you add 2 more persons, obviously it will be done within the half day. Okay, so in a similar manner, what nowadays we are having is we are having the different cores in the microprocessor. Okay, so what you will find that we are having a quad core processor, we are having dual core processors, we are having octa-core processors. Okay, so what we are doing is now we are increasing the number of cores within the microprocessor. Okay, so we have a microprocessor, and within the microprocessor what we are doing is we are now increasing the cores, so that these core will be working together to improve the performance or speed of the particular microprocessor. So that's why the concept of the core has come up. So try to understand that concept, and then you can see this clock speed, and this is our Dennard's scaling law. Fine, so this is our Dennard's scaling law, in which you can understand that the clock frequency was doubling at 34 month, Okay, and now it is already leveled off at around 3 gigahertz. It does not go beyond 3 gigahertz now. Okay, so clock frequency is not further increasing, and this is because of the large number of transistors which is already available on the chip. It is already consuming a very high power, and power is the biggest concern. Okay, so that we have to control. So now you can think of just you try to see the next slide. Okay, the next slide is about the different integration technology. Okay, this must be in your syllabus, like small scale integration. You can see here the different technologies that we have. Okay, so like SSI technology, which is called as the small scale integration technology. Then we have the medium scale integration. Then we had a large scale integration. Then VLSI technology. Then ULSI technology. Then GSI technology. Okay, so these are the different technologies. Okay, so I have taken this picture again from Pucknell's book, right? So you can go through it. So basically, what is this SSI technology? What is MSI, LSI, VLSI? Okay, so you can see the year by which these technologies were introduced. Okay, so basically, it was depending on the technology. Okay, the technology that we had that time. Okay, so how many transistors we can make within a particular chip? That was very much important. Okay, so. That was very much important. Okay, so basically you can see we begin the IC fabrication in somewhere around 1961, right? So means 1958 we had a first IC, and then around the same time the making of transistor were start, making of the ICs were start. Okay, so first technology that we had was your SSI. A small scale integration technology. So a small scale integration technology, so what we have to look at is approximate number of transistor per chip in commercial product. Okay, so how many transistor we were able to make. Okay, so as you already know that we had a particular feature size. I told you about the feature size, the size of the transistor. So we had a particular technology, the particular process by which we could make a particular transistor whose size was limited. Okay, or the size was limited to a particular size. Okay, its feature size was having certain, like it was started with the 20 micrometer, then it was 10 micrometer, 6 micrometer, 3 micrometer, and so on. Okay, so in this particular year, 1961, around this particular range, we were introduced with the SSI technology, small scale integration, and we had a certain devices like we had flip flops, logic gates. Okay, so in these particular logic gates and flip flops, we need to have a number of transistors were less than 10. Okay, like 7404. Okay, 7404. If you go through the IC, this IC is your inverter. Okay, 7404. Okay. So I think it is a hex inverter. So there will be total 6 inverter circuits. So you can go through the 7404 ICs or some other logic gates. Okay, there are so many logic gates. So if you go through the logic gates, what you will find, these logic gates are actually containing number of transistors which was less than 10. Okay, so they were able to only integrate less than 10 number of transistors. Okay, it cannot go beyond 10. Fine. So that was the technology that they had. Okay, so now there is no a particular boundary. Okay, you cannot say that what happens if it is going to 11, what happens if it is going to 12. Okay, so there is no such questions. Okay, so there is a technology, there is a technology like we can embed up to 10 transistors. If it is so, then it is called as the small scale integration. Okay, small number of transistors can be integrated on a particular chip. Okay, then we come up with another process, another technology, which is called as the MSI technology, like medium scale integration. So within the medium scale integration, we were able to integrate up to 1000 transistors. Okay, up to 1000 transistors. So what does it mean? You can definitely integrate 10 transistors, because it is not like that. If MSI technology we are using, then first of all we have to look at what we want to make. Okay, if we want to make a counters, we want to make multiplexer adders, which is required large number of transistors in that time, we will be going for the MSI technology. Okay, so MSI technology means it will be having a different type of process. Okay, other than the SSI process, whatever the SSI process we were following, we have to follow a different process for manufacturing the counters, multiplexers and adders. Okay, so the transistors that we'll be making, that will be using the MSI technology. And if we are following the MSI technology, obviously the feature size will be reduced, the size of the transistor will be reduced, and we will be able to integrate up to 1000 transistors. Okay, so up to 1000 transistors can be integrated into a particular chip. Similarly, if you look at the large scale integration, so this technology was came around 1971. Okay, after 1971, so its development was happened, and then large scale integration in which we can integrate up to 20,000 transistors. Okay, up to 20,000 transistors can be added. So you can see how it is possible, because we are able to reduce the size of the transistor. Okay, so slowly there is a progress in the technology, okay, in the process of manufacturing the IC, and then we could be able to integrate more number of transistors. So up to 20,000 of transistor could be added by using the large scale integration technology. Okay, and the typical example you can see, it is 8-bit microprocessors, ROM, RAM. Okay, these are the typical examples. Okay, these are the typical examples of LSI technology. Okay, similarly, you can see in around 1980, we had 16-bit or 32-bit microprocessors. Okay, so in this particular LSI technology, which is your very large scale integration technology, you can see about 1 million of transistors. Okay, around 1 million of transistors could be added. Okay, so around 1 million transistors. So this is our technology, VLSI means, right? So nowadays, actually, VLSI is very much commonly used for any other other technology also, like even if it is ULSI or GSI. So what is this ULSI? ULSI stands for ultra large scale integration. Okay, so ultra large scale integration means we are able to add more than 1 million transistors. Okay, so more than 1 million transistor, or it is up to 10 million transistor, you can see when we are adding. When we are able to add more than 10 million, it will be called as the giant scale integration. Okay, so obviously there will be a technology transfer, okay, technology change. So one time when we are having LSI or VLSI, then obviously the way we are manufacturing the IC is completely changing. Okay, there must be certain changes that will take place, and then only we will be able to manufacture or integrate so many of transistors, you can see, right? So this is the basic demarcation you can remember, okay, and the typical examples you can remember, like 16 and 32 bit microprocessor or any sophisticated peripherals. Okay, spatial microprocessors, virtual reality machines, smart sensors. Okay, so these are the typical examples, right? So that you can remember, we have the different type of technologies like SSI, MSI, LSI, VLSI, right? So now we have to move on one of the very important topic. Okay, this is one of the very important topic that we have to move on and we have to look at. So first of all, you try to see right now, means till now, whatever we are discussing, we are trying to develop a particular background about this VLSI technology. So what we have done till now is, what we have done, we can understand from the how our technology is evolved from the history, I mean historical background, that we had first our vacuum tubes, which were means occupying a very large space, and out of that, whatever we have made, like our first digital computer ENIAC, they were having a very large size. It was occupying a very large space. It was placed in a building. Then we come up with a particular invention of transistors. Okay, then we also have the invention of ICs, MOSFETs, complementary MOSFET, and because of that, We are able to manufacture electronic gadgets. Those are very much handy and very much portable and very thin in size, okay, very small in size, which is possible. Now the question comes, and there are lots of technology, and we have gone through the Jordan's Moore's law. What is Moore's law says that the size of the transistor can be reduced, or the number of transistors that can be integrated onto a chip is doubling in every 18 months or 24 months and so on, right? Now the question comes, like, there are so many semiconductor material that we have, like the elemental semiconductor we have is basically your silicon and germanium. Then we are also having gallium arsenide is one of the material which is very much popular, okay, and other means other materials are also there. There are so many compound semiconductors that we have, okay. Then we have to think of which particular material we have to choose for fabrication of the IC, okay. So that we have to look at here, okay. There are large number of there are certain properties of your silicon that we have to look at, okay. So there are certain properties that I have outlined here, okay, that you can look at. First of all, the basic thing that we have to look at is, you can see the silicon is very abundant in nature, okay. It is very much abundant in nature, but really having abundant in nature doesn't mean that we have to go for it, okay. It should have certain favorable property for making IC. Otherwise, having an abundance doesn't make a candidate, okay. But just you try to see this, because it is not only abundant in nature, but it is also offering a certain favorable properties for making the IC, okay. So nowadays you know that silicon is one of the major material that our semiconductor industries relies on, okay. They are manufacturing everything, almost everything. 95% of the semiconductor product, if you see, it will be using silicon as the material for manufacturing any electronic gadgets or any electronic component, okay. So first of all, silicon is very abundant in nature, and it is representing about 25.7% of the earth's crust, okay. So it is available in the earth, and its percentage is about 25.7. You know that sand is your silicon, okay. So silicon is available as a sand, and in the nature it is found as a goethite, okay. So its chemical formula is SiO2, silicon dioxide. It is available in the form of SiO2, and it is means representing a very high amount of earth crust, 25.7%. So it is very much abundance. Second thing that we have to look at is, it is a semiconducting material. It is possessing semiconducting property. And second thing is that it's a refining process. If you want to refine this SiO2, because SiO2 itself cannot be used. So SiO2 refining process is very simple. Okay, I will tell you, this is in your syllabus. I will tell you the refining of the SiO2 or getting a pure silicon is very simple. Its process is very simple, okay. The third point, which is very much important, is we can make a very high quality of single silicon crystal, okay. Very high quality of single silicon crystal growth is possible, okay. This is very important thing, to have a single silicon crystal for making an IC. Okay, so what is the single silicon crystal? That I will also tell you, what is the single silicon crystal. So I have written here something about the single crystals. So if we have a single crystals, so single crystals provide uniform and reproducible device characteristics, okay, and thus provide the ability to integrate millions of identical components side by side on a chip, okay. So why this single silicon crystal is required? Because it will provide uniform and reproducible device. Okay, how it is possible, I will explain you now. Okay, so single silicon crystal growth is possible of very high quality. Okay, the second thing, the next thing is a growth of very good quality of SiO2 layer. Okay, right now you will not be able to understand why this SiO2 layer is so important. Okay, But I will tell you that during the manufacturing, okay, of the IC, number of times we need to grow this SiO2 layer, okay, number of times we need to grow, okay, and a very high quality of SiO2 layer and stable SiO2 layer is very much necessary, okay. So right now at this time you try to just understand that the SiO2 layer is a part of manufacturing. It is required in very high quality and a stable SiO2 layer is necessary, okay. And this is possible in the case of silicon. Silicon can give you very high quality of SiO2 layer. Fine. Then one more thing that we have is with the silicon as a material, we have developed one manufacturing process which is called as a planar technology. Okay, planar process. Okay. So this is one of the process that is very much required. Planar process is actually giving you to embed a large number of transistors, okay, in a particular plane, you can say, okay. So when I will discuss you about the fabrication of this ICs, okay, like CMOS fabrication, MOS fabrication, that time I will tell you that how, what is this meaning of the planar process, okay. So planar process is actually giving you a path by which we can means integrate more number of transistors onto a particular plane, okay, and the same plane we can embed a large number of transistors. And obviously 95% of the semiconductor material used by electronic industry is silicon, okay. So because the silicon is having a certain favorable property in terms of IC fabrication, so we will stop here for today, okay. I hope you must have commented your roll number and name on the chat box, okay. It will be automatically recorded, but just you wait for 2 minutes. I will also take this screenshot so that your attendance should not be missed. So last one more point that you can see is a single crystal of silicon and germanium, okay. Who have developed this? It is developed by the Jordan team, okay. The scientist who done this work is Jordan team, single crystal growth, okay, of silicon and germanium at Bell Labs. Fine. So we can stop here. You can just wait for 2 minutes. Okay. Just wait for 2 minutes.